Very good morning once again. Thank you for joining us here on Rush Hour. This is Urban TV. If you've just woken up, it is 1st December and it is World AIDS Day. And if you've just joined us, we have been talking about the World AIDS Day. Globally, we are commemorating this day. We are, remembering the over 40 million people who have died from HIV/AIDS. And those that are living with HIV/AIDS, we are celebrating their strides in that regard. And we want to understand, how are you and I supposed to live with all this around us? So there's a whole lot that is, lined up for you in this discussion, in the big issue. Go to our social media platforms at Urban TV on Twitter, beg your pardon, Urban Television on Facebook, and as well as Eline UG3 on Twitter. And let's have more interesting conversations. What do you think needs to be done? Perhaps you can go to the social media platforms, leave a question or comment. What needs to be done? There seems to be worry that the young girls, the young women, are most at risk recently, or now as we speak, from the ages of 15 to about 35. What do you think is the problem? What could have gone wrong? Leave a question, leave a comment, and we'll get to it maybe later in the show. Now, joining me to discuss that and so much more is Esther Kawasambo. I hope I pronounced it well. Yeah. Young person living with HIV/AIDS, but she's also an activist. She's also, into creating awareness in regards to HIV/AIDS. But also we have Dr. Elizabeth Chihika. Now, Dr. Elizabeth is a member of the National HIV Prevention Committee at the Uganda AIDS Commission. Ladies, I'm glad to have you this morning.
Thank you.
Right, let's just get into it. The global theme is equalize. Now, equalize has been decided because it means everyone should work to eliminate the injustices that are impeding the fight against HIV/AIDS, according to UNAIDS. Now, the theme for this year is the latest in a long line of issues that are causing new infections in regard to HIV/AIDS. I want to begin with Dr. Elizabeth here. Doctor, we have actually, in the lead up to 1st December today, we've had several conversations about AIDS and the status quo in Uganda. But then it seems that it is not just in Uganda that the adolescent girls are affected and young women. It's global. I was reading somewhere and they're saying that defining a woman, they're saying today the face of HIV in Africa is a young girl with a baby on her back who, when faced with a difficult choice of self-care versus childcare, will always sacrifice her own health for her child. In Uganda, for example, adolescent girls were four to five times more likely to be HIV positive than the rest of the population, according to Dr. Andrew Kambugu, the executive director of the Uganda Infectious Disease Institute. How did we arrive at this?
Okay, yes, thank you very much, Lynn, and good morning, our viewers. Yes, it's quite concerning that currently we're seeing most of the infections affecting mainly the adolescent girls and the young women. And this comes in due to a number of issues that have arisen. For starters, these young people are the kind who have not seen the HIV threat that was there before. And remember, there were intensified efforts in terms of information giving,
yes,
at the very beginning.
Yes.
However, right now, yes, the information is there, mm-hmm, but it is not as targeted.
Okay.
We are having young people, and the kind of information, how they access the information is different.
Yes.
So
yes,
we need to revise, how do we reach these young people with this information, mm, about HIV, prevention of HIV. More so, we are also seeing that these young people are affected by other structural issues. Remember, this is an age group that is full of experimenting.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And they rely a lot on their peer educators.
Yes.
And for them to access some of the information, they would need to get it from the health service providers.
Mm.
But many a times you find that they are facing stigma and discrimination.
But of course.
When they come for the services. Yes. So there is need to change the approach as to how we are serving these young people. And I'm happy to say as Uganda, quite a number of steps have been taken. Mm. We are no longer focusing mainly in health facilities. We are taking this to the communities, taking this to the communities through outreaches, mobile outreaches. We are having, looking for different hotspots where we'll find these populations that are now disproportionately affected by HIV AIDS.
Absolutely, absolutely. Esther, it is said that infections among 15 to 24-year-olds accounted for 37% of all new HIV infections in the year 2021. And we understand COVID, of course, was at its height, with new infections occurring three times more among young girls compared to the boys. What do you think has not been done, especially on the side of the young girls?
Thank you so much, Lynn, and good morning to the viewers. I think when you look at the year 2022, this is a year after lockdown. Mm-hmm. And when you look at our culture as Africa, basically Uganda, it is so hard for parents to talk to their children about their sexual reproductive health rights.
That's so true.
So you find this teenage girl who is just 13 years, mm-hmm. and her mind and her body is all about experimenting, getting to know what is happening. But this girl doesn't have the right information.
Yes.
And trust me, few people know where to get the information from, because we have grown up in a state where going to the hospital is when you're sick. Literally, you have malaria or something is wrong and you need to see a doctor. Mm-hmm. So we've not been raised to that, to grow to know that you actually can go to a health center to consult about your health. But besides that, there is a lot of judgment. There is a lot of stigma. Like, imagine a 14-year-old girl coming to ask you about their sexual reproductive health rights. I mean, she'll ask you about family planning, maybe condom use, and she's
and
going to tell
her.
You, my body is reacting, and you cannot even really understand what is happening.
Sure.
So I think basically now when we went in lockdown, and children were at home, because I stay in Chisugu, Waibigalo, and I tried to make some research after about the teenage pregnancies. And in one parish like this, there are 48 teenage pregnancies.
Wow.
And I was trying to find out what was really the problem. But when you look at a setting where I stay, it's a slum. And you know, there is a lot of congestion, there's a lot of people. This is a home where you find one single room, there is a father, mother, and like five kids. And the environment outside is not friendly. So for such people who don't have information of how to access services, it was really hard. Sitting at home and you're not doing anything, and your parent is not talking to you about that, about your life.
And the hormones are raging.
But like, your body is reacting, and besides, you're seeing what other people around you are doing, and there are a lot of temptations around you.
Yes.
And there's no one to guide you. That's where I think most of our teenage girls, most of the girls, most of the adolescents messed up, because there was no one to hold their hand and show them what to do at that moment. Mm. So for the 2 years, that's why you see things have doubled. I mean, the percentages are high, because there was no one to hold their hands. They were not informed, first of all. And it is so hard to make a parent believe that actually someone's hormones might react. Besides, they have not taught them. I mean, like, they've not taken them through their lifestyle. They have not maybe taught them about God, to make these kids maybe grow up being religious, maybe grow up knowing that I can wait until marriage. Like, a kid is just there. There is no support. And they will end up doing what their body tells them to do. After all, no one cares.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Dr. Elizabeth, this actually reminds me that most parents... I mean, we should have learned from what happened previously. Mm. We should. Why haven't parents embraced the idea of sitting down their girls and telling them, you know what, by the way, now that you have gotten your menstruation, A, B, C, D is bound to happen, and if you do this, this is the repercussion. We ought to have learned from our past. What have we? Why are we not learning?
Yes. Thank you so much, Lynn. So, of course, parents remember. They're still having this fear, okay? How do I approach the child? Maybe I'll tell them what they don't know. Maybe when I tell them this, then they'll go ahead and start experimenting. Mm. Then also the cultural norms and values, okay, they play a big role in the way parents decide on is it the right time to communicate this.
Yeah, yeah.
Little do they know is that our world today, our young people are exposed.
Yes.
They are already exposed.
Yes.
Okay. And if they're exposed and have not been equipped with the right information, they're going to look for the information from a fellow peer who also does not know
the
right thing to say. They are going to check the internet. Okay. So what will they find there? So it's high time for parents, okay, to take up the mantle and say, all right, my child is about this age. What information is appropriate for this age?
Yeah.
And of course, as health workers, I know we have also kind of not emphasized that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
We are having the parents are coming in, they're bringing their adolescents, and maybe we are mainly focusing on
what is
cough, flu, the ailments, what's on the table. We have not gone that extra mile to now educate the parent, oh, your child is now in this age bracket.
Yeah.
Start educating them about sexual health, sexual and reproductive health.
Mm.
What should they expect? What should they do when they when they see this happening?
Yes, yes. Yeah. There was a lot of laxity during COVID pandemic lockdowns. And the thing that in spite of the progress we made as a country, about 1,000 Ugandans get infected with HIV every week.
Yeah.
Now, while 325 people die weekly due to HIV, AIDS-related deaths.
Mm-hmm.
This was revealed recently. But now, as we are here, they're saying that there's a huge barrier of inequalities. First of all, what are these inequalities? I want to begin with Esther. Esther here, because you represent the young girls and the adolescents, mm-hmm. the girls, the young women. What inequalities are these that exist, and are we aware of them, or we just think, that's life?
Thank you so much. I think the mere fact that a young person is on the panel right now shows that at least there has been involvement of young people in different spaces.
Mm-hmm.
When we talk about inequalities, it is now we are looking at a boy child and a girl child.
Yes, yes.
I always tell people, like, when they talk about inequalities, now we are talking about equity. I mean, we are not trying to grab something from the boys to add on the girls, but we are trying to make sure that we raise standards. We put an environment that will sustain this boy child and a girl child.
Mm.
I will say, like, when it comes to the education system, I thank God that we have, for us, the millennials, girls and adolescent girls, we came to existence. I mean, when the president had already established the primary university education, UCE, but still it has not been utilized.
Yes.
Because there are still those cultural barriers of a boy child is better than a girl child.
Mm.
A boy child can do this, a girl child cannot do this.
Mm.
So when you find that in a family, I was talking to my friend yesterday when we were talking about the theme, and she was telling me how she passed through a lot because her grandfather didn't believe in girls.
Mm.
And it was so unfortunate that his first daughter got pregnant at campus. And so the bitterness that every girl child in that family has passed through because one girl child got pregnant. So some people look at us and they be like, oh, what are you going to do? You're going to get married and you leave the home. And that is when you find that you are receiving less compared to the male count, to your brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And it affects us girls psychologically, emotionally. And you're asking yourself, why is this happening to me? Why are they prioritizing the other one instead of me? But then when you look at other services, you know, when it comes to girls, like, we are a bit delicate. I mean, we actually need more because we are a bit delicate. Look at teenage pregnancies. We are the ones who are affected highly compared to boys.
Yeah.
So when we talk about inequalities, it is there is something more that needs to be done.
Mm.
When you look at the health systems that we have here in Uganda, when you look at the education systems, it is very true that it is in place, but it is not specifying that it is not very, the environment is not safe for a girl child to go.
Mm-hmm.
Because you find, when you look at sex harassment in institutions and schools, it is us girls who are affected highly. Because it is rare to find a boy complaining about sex harassment. Like, female lecturer tried, you know, to harass him. No, it is us girls. Mm. So when I look at the inequalities, me, what I'm looking at is we need to put equity. You know, when we talk about equity, it is you cannot get someone who has like 10 millions and you and someone has 2 millions and you come in giving 10 millions and you want to make these people equal. You cannot give the one for 10 millions 10. You will first make this one get 10, then the balance they can share equally. Mm. So this is it. We have been receiving less for the past few years, and it is time they make us, they put the equality. And then when they put the equality, then we can be on the same standard. But when you be like, I will give the same punch to these old people, it means that this one who has been having already is going to have more compared to you. So me, I look at the gaps when it comes to health. We really need more special services when it comes. When I reach the hospital as a girl, first of all, my problems are not the same problems as a man. Mm. I will need privacy to talk about my problems. And I will need to talk to a doctor who I feel comfortable, or to any service provider who I feel comfortable talking to, and who is available, not the one who's going to judge me. Mm. When you look at school, the conditions at school for a girl child and for a boy child are totally different. I mean, I'm not saying that we will need more time or special services, but at least they should put in consideration that we are totally different creatures and we need different, I'm not saying different treatment, but they should put in consideration that these people are trying to catch up.
Interesting. Dr. Elizabeth.
Yes, please.
Oftentimes when we talk about ending inequalities, people are thinking, I think you're prioritizing one sex over the other. And which Esther here was trying to, you know, remind us that no, this is not what we are trying to say. But what are those key inequalities that are fueling HIV?
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Lynn. So when we look at what are these inequalities, I'll just give us a few key statistics, okay?
Yeah.
As you mentioned earlier, 4 in 5 new infections are mainly in the adolescent girls and the young women.
Yes.
So what is happening in these adolescent girls and the young women? In Uganda at the moment, we see that 34% of these adolescents by the age of 18 are actually married.
Yes, sadly.
We are seeing a lot of teenage pregnancies. We are seeing a lot of gender-based violence, sex and gender-based violence happening. Mm-hmm. And remember, these are young people who are not empowered to negotiate, okay? To negotiate, for example, for safer sex or to say no, okay? They are not empowered. Then our socio-economic situation, where we find that the girl child now has to go out and also look for money.
Yes.
A recently released report by UNESCO was actually revealing that quite a high percentage of sex workers are actually adolescent girls and young women.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So in other words, they are going there to look for money to sustain themselves. Mm. And the girl child has quite a number of needs, more than the boy child. Mm. Okay. So when these are not catered for, they will try to look for alternative ways. That's where the young girl will be like, oh, I have a boyfriend will come and easily, not a boyfriend, a boy will come and easily deceive that, oh, here is some money, okay? And the girl will be like, oh, I still need this resource.
Yes.
So for me to continue receiving this resource,
I mean, what does it take
It doesn't hurt.
Mm.
Little do they know that they're actually exposing themselves. So when we don't empower them that, hey, please, one, abstain. When not possible, take the necessary measures, okay? For example, consistently, correctly use condoms, okay? But these are some things that we seem not to want to talk about.
Yeah, I don't know why it is so hard to talk about these things, because now they are so glaring in our societies.
Mm.
And talking of things not to talk about, they're saying the main drivers of new HIV infections include multiple sexual partnerships. Mm-hmm. If you remember correctly, I think I was at university, we had a robust campaign against HIV, and that was, I think, cross-generational sex, and then there was multiple sexual partners. I don't know if they're still existing. So we have sexual and gender-based violence, which we've talked about, negative social cultural norms and values, and lack of access to condoms. The other day, Kenya was saying they're out of condoms. Uganda, I don't know how we are doing. Alcohol abuse, income inequality, poverty, high levels of school dropouts, stigma and discrimination. Now, with all these present in our societies, Esther and Dr. Elizabeth, here we are saying ending inequalities. Is there such a thing as ending inequalities? Will we ever reach a point, Esther, will we get to a point in our lifetime where there will be such a time that we have ended most of these inequalities and we can all, you know, live happy?
To me, I think this is something that needs combined efforts. Mm. If we play our different roles, we can actually achieve this. Because since we have already seen the problem, and we have seen the root cause of the problem, and we have seen the effects, and we have also come up with solution, that means if we do what it takes, if we all fulfill our responsibilities, then we can come to an end of, okay, it might be a bit hard, but at least we can bridge the gap, yeah, and okay, like I will look at, for example, the programs of AGYWs.
Okay.
When you look at the programs, for example, DREAMS, only that, the only problem is that
people might not know what DREAMS is.
it is a program. It is in Uganda and some other different countries that is basically empowering adolescent girls and young women with skills economically, financially, with information to help them, information about HIV, prevention, treatment, and care. So, but the only challenge we have is that this program is not in the whole country. It is specifically in some districts. Okay. And when you look at the girls who have been empowered, because I've had a chance to volunteer at Elizabeth Glazer Pediatric AIDS Foundation in Imbara. Mm-hmm. And I've been going to these different training sites of the DREAMS project. Mm. And when you look at the adolescent girls and young women, when they come in and after 6 months when they're leaving, they are totally different. They are really empowered. Like, she can do something. She has been empowered with skills. She can make crafts and she can get money, because one of the biggest challenges we have is the income inequality.
Yes.
Because now, for us girls now, remember, you grow up at home and sometimes you're not allowed to move out.
Mm.
You stay at home, you do household chores, but your brothers can move out. So you are grown up in a setting where you're not exposed to the world. You don't know what is there, and out of a blue, you are out of the home.
Mm.
You don't have any income. You don't have a job. It depends whether you're educated or not. Like, you're there and now you are looking for survival. That's why you see some girls end up going for sex work. They will end up being used by men because they are looking for money. They are looking for survival, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, if there is an opportunity for these girls to be empowered, it would actually be better. And then another thing I'm looking at is, what if, as the country, we start these things to our little children? Now I'm talking about 12 and below. I mean, this young girl grows up from kindergarten, comes to P1, knowing that I actually have a purpose. I can be this. I can study, I can achieve this. I mean, when you mentor someone from kindergarten, from these early childhood years, and she grows up empowered in that way, trust me, you can never deceive such a girl. When she grows up, whether she completes the university or not, the mentorship, the knowledge, the wisdom you have imparted in this kid is not going to go away. So the problem is, we now come, like, we meet these adults and girls and young women when they've already fallen into problems, when they're already facing challenges.
Mm.
And now we are trying to solve the challenges, but we have not moved back to know the background of this girl. What actually happened? Did she face gender-based violence? Was the home where she grew up from good?
Mm.
What was it when she was growing up?
Yes, yes.
And we jump into conclusions to solve the problems that we don't know where they came from for this specific adolescent girl.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm saying, what if the government and CSOs and development partners come up with programs that target the children? I mean, we can raise a generation of boys and girls who know that they have equal rights, who know that they have equal resources, who know that they have equal services,
mm-hmm.
and they grow up, and we raise a generation of adolescent girls, of adolescent boys, young women and men who have equality, who have access to everything.
Absolutely. Thank you. Empowered in and trust and believe in themselves. Yeah. Oh, wow. That's very powerful. Very powerful indeed. Dr. Elizabeth, so we have these inequalities. And we are trying to fight them. But we know that if I'm actually picking lessons from Esther, the problem is that we want to address the current challenge these inequalities are posing. Mm. But there's a problem. They have been here long before we were here. Mm. And so now we are trying to, are we backtracking in any way? Are we trying to, I don't understand, but when we say we're ending inequalities, is there a possibility, really, of such a time?
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you so much, Lynn. And thank you so much, Esther, for that. For one, a problem known is already a problem half solved.
Yes, yes.
And, of course, a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a first step. Mm-hmm. Thankfully, we've recognized where the problem is. The next step is really to find ways to address this at the different levels. Mm. So where are the gaps? As she already hinted on, why not start when they're very young, okay? Most of our programming has dwelt a lot on the, when we're saying adolescent girls and young women, mainly on the 15
yes.
to 24.
Yes.
And we have missed out on the critical years, the 10 to 14.
Yes.
The time when the young person's mind can be shaped, okay? Mm. The young person can be empowered, okay? So really looking at some of the structural barriers, okay, as well, in the cultural, our sociocultural norms,
yeah.
okay? Engaging, okay, the parents, the community leaders, religious leaders, we need all these on board if we are to actually end inequalities. Mm. So a number of things are already being worked on, are already in place. Uganda AIDS Commission actually has been working on a policy on inequalities, ending inequalities. Mm-hmm. And once we're fully disseminated, I'm sure that it will do quite a lot in taking us towards that time when we're actually ending the inequalities.
Yes, please. Very interesting. Somebody was asking, is there really hope that we can overcome HIV/AIDS in our lifetime? And they were giving statistics and saying that 75% of all people living with HIV in Uganda have already reached viral suppression. It is possible in other countries as well. Now, for context, globally, according to UNAIDS report, 59% people living with HIV have reached viral suppression. In South Africa, particularly, it has reached 89%. This is according to the latest report by UNAIDS. And it is very, very interesting. And this will bring me back to you, Dr. Elizabeth,
yes,
because
please.
You have been in this for a while. Is there really hope of overcoming HIV/AIDS? Mm-hmm. And now we're not looking at the fewer new infections, but also looking at the ones living with HIV/AIDS, mm-hmm. because if we've reached a point where there's virus suppression, mm. I mean, people also need to understand virus suppression.
Mm.
But if we've reached that point of having about, we have quite a number, 75% of those living with HIV have already hit virus suppression.
Mm.
Is there hope, really?
Mm. Yes, thank you so much, Lynn. The current statistics for Uganda, we are around 92%.
Oh, whereas we have shot to that point.
Yes.
That's good.
And that gives us great hope because
yes.
with viral load suppression,
mm.
we have the U equals U, undetectable
mm.
equals untransmissible,
right.
which is one of the key strategies we are looking at one also reducing the number of new infections.
Okay.
So we are doing all that we can to see that those who have been identified
mm.
to be having HIV, they are actually started on antiretroviral medication.
Yeah.
And when they're on antiretroviral medication, we want to optimize and make sure that they actually adhere to the medication. Years back, we were having quite a number of formulations, medicines that were quite challenging.
Mm.
But we are now at a point where the medication is simple to take, okay? The frequency is just once a day, okay?
Okay.
So we are encouraging people, please go get to know your status, because the earlier you get to know your status,
the better.
The earlier you're able to be started on treatment in the event that you're HIV positive.
Mm-hmm.
And in the event that you find that you're HIV negative, what are the measures you can take to make sure you prevent yourself from acquiring HIV?
Mm-hmm.
And we are in an era where there are quite a number of things that can be done, okay? And we're right now promoting what we call combination HIV prevention. We are trying to see that prevention comes at a bigger lens at the moment as well.
Yeah.
Where we want to see, in the event that you're at risk, okay, and you're not able to consistently and correctly use condoms, make sure your partner is tested. If not, be able to start on pre-exposure prophylaxis, okay, which is now currently available, okay, in many of the health facilities, and it is free of charge, okay? So everyone, when you go and test, the first step is to test for HIV.
Yes.
When you test, if you're negative, how can you remain negative?
I want you to hold that point. I'm sorry to cut you short, but we need to take a break. And also, Esther, be thinking about the issue that with these numbers, with this the availability of antiretroviral drugs, there's some sort of laxity of, HIV is malaria. We shall manage. Do stick around. We're returning. We're taking a short break. We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Big Issue here on Urban TV. You are in time for us looking at issues, World AIDS Day being 1st December. And we're looking at ending inequalities, and the global theme is equalize. But now here in Uganda, we've broken it down, particularly targeting ending inequalities among adolescent girls, young women, and boys. And it is targeted because recent statistics indicate that is the bracket where the new infections are. And so before we took a break, Dr. Elizabeth here was telling us how most of the people living with HIV/AIDS, actually 92% of people living with HIV/AIDS in Uganda have reached virus suppression. This is a point where you have the virus, but you cannot infect another person, if I'm correct, doctor.
Mm-hmm. So it's 92% of those who are on treatment.
On treatment.
Yes.
Oh, not yes. Those with HIV, but
yes.
Those on treatment.
Yes,
my apologies.
On treatment.
Yes.
So 92% of those who are on treatment.
Yes.
But the unfortunate bit is those who are HIV infected and know their status, we are still below 90. We are at 89%. In other words,
they know, but they're not on medicine.
Only 89% of those who are HIV positive actually know their status.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
So that's why we are overemphasizing, we need people to go and test. Okay. To go and test and know their status. Because once the person tests and know their status, immediately, because we are now having the test and treat. Okay.
Yes.
The test and treat is doing very well. We are now over 95%, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Those who have tested found their HIV positive and are actually enrolled on treatment.
Yes.
So now these ones who are enrolled on treatment, of those who have been enrolled on treatment, at least 92% are actually achieving viral load suppression. So we need to make sure that all those who are HIV infected and are in the community get to know their status. Because when they get to know their status, the chances of them being started on treatment are high. And when they are on treatment, then we will have viral load suppression.
Mm.
And when we have viral load suppression, what that translates to is the the risk of transmission of HIV
right.
becomes much lower.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's good. Esther, from what Dr. Elizabeth is explaining, and from what I have heard from fellow youth, is that I would rather be pregnant than have HIV than, you know, be pregnant. That is one. Two, have the availability of services, HIV AIDS related services, antiretroviral drugs, PrEP, you know, pre-exposure, prophylaxis, all those things. Is this the reason why most youngins, as they like to call themselves, have relaxed?
Thank you so much for that, Lynn. First of all, sometimes for us as young people, we tend to look at things on a close range. Like we don't take time
short
to
term.
Short term. We don't look at the long term part of it, because when you hear that some girls who say, "I'd rather have HIV instead of pregnancy," and in their mind, maybe they're not thinking that HIV is something that is long term. You know, because as for now, the science has not yet brought up medicine.
Yeah.
So that means that you're going to be with this disease for the entire life, for your entire life.
That's right.
So, and when it comes to pregnancy, it is 9 months, you give birth, raise a kid for 1 year or 2 years, and you continue with your business. I'm not saying after 2 years you leave the responsibility, but okay, this is the crucial time of you have to be with your kid all the time.
Mm.
So when you look at the HIV services, I think one of the biggest challenges that young people face is stigma. I will go back to stigma because it is key. It is affecting young people so much. Now, I want to picture a picture for a health center.
Mm-hmm.
So there are different departments in a hospital.
Mm-hmm.
There is antenatal, there is OPD, there is maternity, and then there is ART. So ART is specifically for HIV,
mm-hmm.
prevention, treatment, care, everything related to HIV, you go specifically in that department.
Mm-hmm.
So whoever enters in a hospital, they know that that place is for people living with HIV. So by all means, if you are moving around the hospital and you find your legs in that place,
in that department,
people around you will immediately tell she has come for HIV.
Jesus.
There was a scenario, I was in prime, I was in senior two.
Yes.
I went to this hospital where I used to pick my medication from.
Mm.
And now I found my village mate. So this woman had a bar in our trading center. She was really hot. She really looked good. Every man loved her in the village. So no one knew her status. So all of a sudden, we bump into each other now, because me too, my parents didn't want me to get medicine close to the home because there is that stigma.
Yes.
So they would give me transport, go very far. Still, this man was also going very far. So we meet ourselves in this place, yet we are village mates.
Mm-hmm.
I look at her, she looks at me. So now they used to read files, they read your name. So and so.
And you go.
So this one, she saw me, she immediately moved out of the hospital.
Wow.
So they are calling her name. So and so, I'm like, hey, Msawa, that is my village mate. I saw her around. And we were looking for this woman the whole day. We didn't see her. Why? She thought, I would tell people that we met in the same. Not knowing that actually we are now in this together. I cannot tell people because you will also tell people about me.
Yes.
So now there is this stigma of young people fear to go to hospitals. Now you have stepped in that, a very handsome guy is passing by and now you're there.
You're confused.
You get. So like it's a bit confusing for young people.
Yes.
And then there are also challenges when it comes to accessing treatment and services.
Mm.
Now when you look at the young people in Uganda, we don't have collar jobs, these office jobs.
Mm.
So our jobs are shopkeepers, saloon,
sales,
hotels,
assistants.
Sales assistant.
Yes.
You go to NASA, print books, do those things, embroidery. So you see, this is casual work.
Mm.
And in Uganda, such casual work, you work from Monday to Sunday.
That's right.
From morning to evening.
That's right.
So it comes a point where you need services or you need your medicine and you cannot access it, because asking permission from your boss is, that means you have to explain why you are,
yes,
you are only missing.
And that becomes also another issue.
It is a issue of disclosure.
Yes.
Now, when you disclose, I promise you that the job is not going to be yours.
That's true.
From that day.
Mm.
Because they will be like, oh, you're not going to give us the better services we expect since you're sick.
Mm.
There is that stigma still in the workplaces. So you find this young person, even if they test, because I actually was talking to Dr. Dan from UAC sometime, and I'm like, I don't know how you get these statistics. I don't know if you go to private clinics outside there, or if you rely on the information in health centers for government.
Mm.
Because for us young people, it is hard for me to just match to Alive Care medical services, basically for HIV, to test. I would first go to a clinic, test, find out my status. If it is okay, praise God. If it's not okay, then I will have to first sit down and plan how I go about this.
That is if you do not kill yourself.
That is if I don't get someone to sit on me and be like, because now my mental health is now a problem.
Yeah.
So as young people, we actually face very many challenges, and they are all associated, and we have not yet come to get a solution for them. Because you find it so hard. Accessing treatment itself, it is so hard. When you get a chance to escape from, because I have a friend, she always tells me, when the boss comes in and makes the accounting, what records, and the boss moves out, now she tells the friend, you know what, step in for me, I'm going there. Now she runs to the hospital. Now you're reaching the hospital. Our setting as hospitals in Uganda specifically, the ones I've seen,
right,
you have to be in a queue.
Yeah.
That queue, you will take like an hour or two. See the doctor who is going to give you what?
Medication.
Your medication. Now, seeing the doctor, now you might find out there are other services, like they want to do cancer screening, they want to do maybe viral load and some other. So by the time you get to the pharmacy to get your medicine
and you rush back to work,
you have taken like 3 hours. Already your boss has stepped in, you're in big trouble. So when you combine all these challenges, you find that accessing treatment is hard. When you tell this young person you're going to start medication, she starts calculating a lot of things.
That's
and these
true.
Are realities that are happening to us.
Mm.
And so that is sometimes because when these people who say I would rather be HIV positive, some of them are not informed about what it means to take medicine. Because
yeah,
I can tell you there are days you'd be like, oh God, I'm tired, I cannot do this anymore.
Mm.
And in your life you're like, oh Esther, you
but
have a lot
I
of
don't.
Things to achieve.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a lot of things to do. I have a purpose to fulfill. I still have a lot of, I need to do some things. And you'd be like, okay, wake up, take medicine, go back to sleep, because you will have to produce kids. You want kids who are negative. So by all means, you have a lot of things to achieve.
Mm.
And then you will take medicine. But that is where the loopholes come in for young people when it
yeah.
comes to viral load suppression.
Yeah.
Because now some people lose hope. Like, after all, I'm going to die. Because the parents are like, you will
yes.
die. Everyone is like, you will
you die.
Die. And then there is no way you can convince this young person that take medicine. Because at the end of the day, they have already cultivated their life. And they know they are going to do what? Because that's what they used to tell us when we were growing up. Mother used to culture it for me years. After when my dad died, they'd be like, give her 2 years. Now the 2 years, I pass by God's grace.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still alive. Oh, they keep on adding. I think until when I joined the university, and they're like, ah, it's like this girl is going to be alive. It's like she's not dying anytime soon.
Mm.
But it was not because maybe it was separate, but it was because I reached a point and I realized, no, HIV cannot define you. You have a lot to achieve on this planet. I mean, I'm too ambitious for life. So I looked at myself and I'm like, you know what? Pick yourself up. There is no one to pick yourself, to pick you up. Walk in this journey. Know what to do. Now I had to meet doctors, my friends. Get to know what, because I was already on second line. Because I was looking at myself, if I go to third line, that's total death, because the drugs in my hospital, it was not there.
Mm.
So I had to now start taking the treatment very well so that I could do what? Suppress. But I can promise you that very few people, young people know about this.
I know.
Very few people have these ambitions because, first of all, when you look at the local setup, kids, like, that's why you see there are very many teenage pregnant. They don't have dreams. They even don't have role
they
models.
They don't know what it means to have dreams.
They even don't know what's next, because for her, it is grow up.
Mm-hmm.
Get married.
Wow.
You get.
Wow.
And that's it.
And that's the end of the story. Anyway, Dr. Elizabeth,
yes,
oh
yes.
My God, she has really powerful messages there. Dr. Elizabeth, as we conclude this conversation, and we are looking at in ending inequalities among these adolescent girls, Esther is raising very, very key issues for the youth. How do we target our focus on how can we target the youth in what form to end these inequalities, but also to remind them not to actually get into sex, to expose themselves.
Okay. Yes. Thank you very much. For starters, Ministry of Health, Uganda AIDS Commission are taking up quite a number of innovative approaches targeting the adolescent girls and young women, okay? They're at the heart of, right now, the HIV response, okay?
Yeah.
So a number of things we've seen. One, we want to have extended hours at the health facilities because we know some of them are in school and they have to come to come to receive their medication.
That's right.
Then we are having a lot of community approaches, okay? Where, for example, we are having the pharmacy refill. So instead of the person coming and lining up, they just go to the pharmacy and pick their medication. A pharmacy in the community, not at the facility.
Because they've sent their details to that pharmacy.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So it is still a bit slow in uptake, but it is picking. It is speaking. It is one of the models we are looking at to see there is a reduction in congestion at the health facilities, such that we reduce the long waiting hours, as Esther said.
Yes.
The 3 hours you leave your work and you have to spend 3 hours to just come and pick your refill.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to reduce that to a maximum of 2 times in a year.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And that is achievable once the person has a suppressed viral load.
Okay.
Okay. They'll be able to come just twice in a year. That's when they'll have to see the doctor and go through the process. The rest of the months of the year, they're in position to receive their treatment in the community. Okay, so we're looking at a number of innovative approaches in that. Then when it comes to reaching the young girls who are yet to be infected, well, looking at what interventions can we use to target them with the information, appropriate information. We're having a lot of peer-to-peer models or approaches happening, looking that we empower some of the adolescent girls and young women to reach out to fellow adolescent girls and young women, because we've seen that most of them are going to look for information from fellow peers.
Yes.
Okay, so we're looking at, okay, how do we engage more of these young people to reach to more young people? What mods, how can we reach them? We see there are many are now also into technology. Okay, how do we use WhatsApp to reach them with information?
Yes.
This is also already a program that is reaching them, because I know Urban is watched by a young generation.
Yes.
So I'm sure some who are listening in today, I'm hoping that after the program, if you don't know your status, you'll run to test.
Absolutely.
And then when you test, you now you'll say, okay, if you're HIV positive, don't lose hope, start treatment. If you're HIV negative, ask the health worker, how can I stay negative? Okay. And of course, to the health workers and the parents, we need to overcome ourselves, the values that keep holding us behind. Okay. That, and many a times I tell my friends that the nonverbal communication speaks a lot.
Volumes, yeah.
The young person has come for contraceptive pills, and the health worker takes a second look. Okay. We need to overcome that stigma and discrimination at the health facilities, so that the young people are able to come freely, just walk in and get any service that they
absolutely
want.
Absolutely. Esther, in a minute, what would you want the young women to know?
First of all, I'm going to add something from hers. So together with my fellow Y Plus ambassadors, we came up with an innovation of delivering drugs to our fellow young people, because we found out it was the biggest problem. So these people order for their medication, like they send us the details. We go to the health centers, we do the lining and the queuing for them.
Do you have an app? Do you have
We are building an application, but for now we are using social media. Our foundation is called Unreach DigTech Foundation. So many people order like on Facebook, sometimes Twitter. Okay, we have many of Twitter. Twitter and sometimes on the groups of young people living with HIV.
Okay.
Like we send in the flyers and they come to us for services.
So,
but in conclusion, I'm going to tell, when it comes to adolescent girls and young women, all I can tell them is just know your values, know what you want. Me, I always tell people to abstain. Abstain from sex if you're not married, if you're not ready for the consequences of sex, please abstain. As simple as that. Then, you know, there are sometimes those who cannot manage. And when we talk about the use of condoms, correct, consistent use of condoms. I love the word consistent, because many people are not consistent. I mean, they will use it the first time, the second time, and the third time they will leave it. And then there is that risks of getting HIV. So I would encourage other methods of prevention. There is PrEP, there is PEP. Reach out to the facility and get to know with which method can really work for you to stay safe.
Right.
And then I would also encourage parents to please take up your mantle. Do your responsibilities. Talk to your adolescent girls. Talk to them about the life. tell them the reality, because they are hiding the reality from us. Tell us the reality, the harsh realities of life. Do not make us sit there and not to understand what is happening outside.
Absolutely.
Because at the end of the day, when we get problems, it goes back to you.
Absolutely. Wow. Powerful conversation we've had. Thank you, Esther. Thank you, Dr. Elizabeth, for making time. And we have been looking at World AIDS Day. I urge you, if you do not know your status today, at least for today, try, you know, grab some courage. Get up. Take yourself to a nearest health center, health facility, and get tested. It will help you a great deal. And trust me, once you find you're negative, you won't be the same. If you are positive, still you will not be the same, but you will be started on medication to help you live positively. We have people giving testimonies that they are living positively and they have managed to live their lives purposefully. So do stick to that and also go and get tested. I urge you, please go get tested. I am also going to a health camp here to get tested, so you can also join me and but do stick around. Rush Talk is still here until 10. So Rush Talk comes in with Miles in just a bit. A very good morning to you.